actually, it's a delight to see some familiar faces in the audience. I've had some feedback from Mr. Geddes about last night on my lack of detail. The problem is here, some of you know an awful lot about mining. In fact, I can see some people that know considerably more than I will ever know about mining. Some of you don't. So my job tonight, I think, is to try and pique your interest. I'm, like Jeremy, I'm also an optimist. But I'm going to try and back that up with a fair amount of substance and pique your interest sufficiently enough, perhaps, to come to us afterwards and look at the detail. And there is plenty of material on our website, in our releases, and indeed, you know, come and find me afterwards. So I'm going to try and pique your interest to get you to come onto the website, sign up, and actually have a look for some of the detail Mr. Geddes requires and needs and understands. So my name's Dominic Roberts, Head of Corporate Affairs at Adriatic Metals. We are a joint listed on the London main market and the ASX, UK-based developer of one of the highest margin polymetallic projects anywhere in the world that is being brought to bear here at the moment. Now that's what we're doing, but actually what I'm going to talk about quite a lot today is I'm going to use the word Europe a lot, because quite a lot of why I think this project is even more interesting than its economics, even more interesting than its ore body and its grade, is actually what is going on in Europe, where we are in Europe, and where we're going to be going forward as well in Europe. 2 years ago, when we were looking at our risk register, we did have a pandemic in there, but we weren't paying any attention. What we certainly did not have was war on continental Europe and all the changes that is now accelerating. What we started to see in the last 4 or 5 years, some people call it deglobalization, it doesn't really matter what title you give it, it is happening. I was in Brussels last week with the Raw Materials Initiative and something called DG Grow, who are responsible for European manufacturing policy. They are drafting policy in Brussels at the moment, looking at subsidizing new smelting capacity in Europe, looking at ways to require member states to increase raw material production, looking at drafting bilateral agreements, raw materials agreements. Canada is at the top of their list, because they are deeply concerned. We have no chance of hitting net zero. Europe has no chance of doing that without these raw materials. And supply line fragility, resource scarcity is what is going on now. And we need more materials, and Europe needs to start producing them itself. And we, I think, will be one of the parts of that story. Our project has captivating economics. Our DFS last year put out a post-tax NPV8 of just over $1 billion. That was using prices at the time in October last year, and prices have moved, but we resist the temptation to re-rate constantly. I think the largest figure here is our rate of return at 134%. It's huge. There's a reason why. This is a brownfield operation. This was mined by the Yugoslavians. This stopped operations in 1988, but what we were left with were roads, electricity, an awful lot of the infrastructure. Critically, we have a dedicated railhead at site that will take our future production down to main port in Croatia. And these are big, big ticket items. And those reduce our capital costs to 168 million. That is a very small amount for what we are going to be doing. This is an 850,000 ton a year polymetallic mine with two flotation lines producing a lead silver and a zinc concentrate. In fact, our payback period on that debt is 8.5 months. These are pretty stellar figures. And this is what has taken us forward now into a fully funded project, and we are now 6 months into construction of that already. And in June 2023, we will be producing our first concentrates. In our first 5-6 years of production, we produce over 200 million EBITDA a year. Big figures. It does drop off, but as I come on later, it's still profitable, but as I come on later, our exploration successes are starting already to identify how we'll ameliorate that drop in revenues in 5-6 years' time. We are one of the lowest cost new silver projects things. We are a polymetallic. We produce silver, lead, zinc, copper, gold, and antimony, but we have a very large 35% of our revenue comes from silver. So we tend to rate ourselves against our silver performance. At $7.4 per ounce of silver, that puts us right at the top of our peers globally in terms of our all-in sustaining cost. If you translate that into a different metric, perhaps one we used to use a bit more, broadly equates to $70 a ton of ore presented to the mill. Okay, and actually, if you did a bit of maths, you could work out what our concentrate grade of silver is from that. But again, that's all on the website. It's all available. Very, very low-cost mine. And indeed, I've already been through our return. No great surprise, perhaps, that we sit up there as one of the highest returns possible or in the market against all of our peers as well. And again, in the back of the presentation, you'll see, Mr. Geddes, all the tables to give you the reassurance on the peer comparisons we've done. We are flying through this project. We actually acquired it in 2017. There was an indication of something interesting in the area. The Yugoslavians had drilled a couple of holes in the end, 1987-88, that had hit mineralization. But there was no resource on it. There was just an indication. We acquired this in 2017. In 2018, we had our discovery hole, which a few of you might even know. One of the highest grade intercepts that was put out anywhere in the world that year. That got us onto the ASX. We kept drilling. We got listed on the London main market, where we are today as well. And also we have an OTC in New York listing, as some of our other talkers this evening have had. Maiden resource, pre-feasibility in October. Definitive feasibility, definitive in 2021. Critically, we achieved our financing very quickly after that. Our financial partner is Orion Resource Partners, based out of New York. And they provided a finance package I'll describe a little bit later. We completed our ESIA. We started construction in November last year. So we are now 8 months into construction. We are underground on our declines. The haul road is being constructed. The processing plant has its foundations going in now. The long lead times are all ordered and locked in, with deliveries commensurate with our project budget and timeline. Pretty much covered this. What we see here is that we go forward into a processing plant that is up and running in February 2023, where we'll start what we call cold commissioning, running water, making sure it's working, and then moving forward into April, where we'll start the hot commissioning and starting to put ore in. Just putting back a second, the declines are 300 metres long. We're already starting to advance underground. That's because our operating concept is to bring a stockpile of ore up to surface from September of this year ahead of the commissioning so that we have a balance of ore. Just a small note on this, and someone very correctly asked me yesterday about this. This is a polymetallic mine. We have a smorgasbord of metals in here, and those that you know about that sort of mineral deposit know that these aren't the easiest thing to process. When you have got quite so much chemistry going on in your ore. The way you get around that is through what we call a geometallurgical approach, so that actually we went across our whole ore body, we've got 12 million tonnes in our resource, took samples out of that and looked to create what we call domains, so areas where the ore behaved in a certain way under processing. I think at one point we had 42 different domains. That's not practical, you can't run a mine on that. So we've brought that down to a manageable number of domains. Each of those has a slightly different characteristic. And one of our jobs, as it is with many polymetallics, is actually to be blending our ore continuously to make sure that we get optimized recoveries of our metals in there. There are points where our grade is so high that we will be blending in waste rock into the ore that is being presented to the processing plant. Because if we present too high grades, we actually start to lose recovery, if that makes sense. I think it should do. So we have a 12 million tonne resource on Rupitsa itself, but Rupitsa is open down dip below it, to the south, more importantly to the west, to the northwest. And we started to see indications of that last year. We put the resource on the ore body, even though we knew there was further exploration to do, because we were ready. And actually, we had such captivating economics in that ore body, we didn't have to continue the exploration drilling for our resource. We could get on and finance this project and bring it to bear. Our drill rigs are running to the northwest. We are intercepting very, very heavily mineralized ore to the northwest. It is very similar, actually, to the ore that we were discovering right at the start of the Rupitsa. And there will be an exploration update issued to the markets very, very shortly, which will confirm what we are starting to see, which is life of mine tendencies from there. At the moment, we're on a 10-year life of mine. We'll increase that actually for some infill drilling on Rupitsa itself, but this exploration work is showing very strong indications of increasing that life of mine and showing very strong indications of grade that will actually help us where we saw that economic tail off a little bit in our performance after year six start to replace that. Things are coming together. this is the right project. But that's also just the start of it. Rupica, we have a 42 kilometer square land package. It's the largest exploration license issued in Bosnia. And the reason why we've done that is that we have locked up the whole of that. We put an awful lot of work into trying to work out the genetic model, how this ore body got there at Rupica. And in so doing, we identified the geological structure, which is a contact between two sedimentary zones that hosts Rupica. And elsewhere in the world, deposits like this tend to repeat. There are parallels that can be drawn with others. Of course, they're not going to be identical. And we've locked up that whole structure. Rupica's up here. The processing plant in Vares is here. It's 27 kilometres away. Yes, we've got to build a haul road. The reason why it's there is twofold. Firstly, because that's where the historic processing plant was for the old Yugoslavian mine, and that's where we've got rail, road, electricity that bring our costs down on our IRR so up. But it's also because this is going to end up being a hub and spoke operation. We have prospective targets across this region. We've flown it with airborne survey. We've done the soils. We've done all the mapping. This year, as the rigs start to come off some of the infill definition drilling, which we're just doing for the first 2 years of mine plan at Rupica, we'll start to move to some of our other targets. Droskovac, there's a historical resource on there from Yugoslavian times. SP1 and SP2, huge magnetic anomalies, very, very similar to Rupica as well. So we believe what we're looking at here is not just a 10-year mine, 12-year, 15, whatever we get to on Rupica, but actually a truly generational mine that will take us through for many, many years. Bosnia. we're on the continent, we're on continental Europe. Yes, we're not in the EU. Yes, our history is one that was a bit painful, but our future is going to be a whole lot better. We permitted this project, it start to finish, in just over 2 years. I think it took us 26 months to achieve all of our permits. Bosnia deserves a gold medal for that. Elsewhere in the world, 10, 15 years would be expected as an average. One of the reasons why, there's two main reasons. One of the reasons why is that this project is so significant. We contribute 1.5% to GDP in full operation. We're 25% of foreign direct investment this year, okay? Obviously, there's not a huge amount of foreign direct investment, but government stands up and takes notice of us. We'll become instantly the largest exporter. We'll become one of the largest taxpayer in the country. We will create thousands of jobs by the time we go to the spin-off and the indirect jobs and all the supply chain. So that's part of the story. But the other part of the story, actually, is that from the very start, we have, I'm very proud to say this, we've managed to do the right thing. We have developed that relationship with our community, with our canton, we have a cantonal system, with our federal government, whereby actually they trust us and they've been issuing us permits. One of the examples is we completed our Bosnian environmental impact assessment, the one that was required to build the mine and get an operating license, and that was all we needed to do. There was no requirement to do an ESIA in the country, but we did an ESIA. EBRD are one of our shareholders. Actually, they didn't require it either, but with them, we worked through a full internationally compliant ESIA. And it was in doing the ESIA, because we had the S bit in there, the social bit, is when we really, really engaged with our communities and started to understand what it is they expected from us. And during that, we identified one of the issues here, that Bosnia doesn't have a royalty system. So most mining jurisdictions, the governments will charge you 5%, 6%, 7%, a royalty on the things. Bosnia has what's called a concession fee, and our concession fee was originally struck, was 0.8 NSR, net smelter royalty, so it was 0.8%. Brilliant for the screaming capitalists, but it's not going to work, because in the end, the community that hosts this ore body, the community that owns this ore body, is not going to see the returns that it expects. We have voluntarily increased our concession agreement. We've also set up a foundation, which I'll cover a little later, to further bridge that sort of gap. So I've moved on to sustainability. I've already started talking about it. I think I'll just pull back a second. 25 years ago, it was the financial community that actually stopped the naughty natural resources sector from behaving badly. Started off really with the Equator Principles for responsible lending in the extractive industry. But that was perverse and a little bit wrong, because that was the financiers, famous themselves for their behavior, telling us what to do, not us actually taking our own initiative. 25 years later, or nearly 25 years later, that has changed dramatically. We went through CSR, corporate social responsibility. That was reporting. It was just putting the right things down on a piece of paper. We moved into the period of ESG. Again, much heading right direction, but still the problem with ESG is that E and the S and the G are separate in their little silos. And we in the mining industry already have enough problem with silos between the miners and the geologists and the processing guys. And ESG was also, that's why we're all moving on to what sustainability. And that is where the conversation is going, because, and that is absolutely right. It has to have that whole view. And we've seen that as well with our community. We went out in the ESIA, the feedback that they gave us of what they expected us to do to actually have the right. Forget the fact you've been given a license by the government. That ore body's owned by the community. And they'll kick you out faster than the government will, quite frankly. We also did a health impact assessment. We didn't need to do that. That identified some very specific health challenges that we've also taken actions to resolve those as well. We completed a full land acquisition, resettlement, compensation action plan. Again, we didn't need to do that, but under EBRD, we did that. We did that very successfully. We had to acquire some land. Next door to us in Serbia, one of the world's largest lithium projects, was very nearly derailed from its land acquisition. And that is a company 100,000 times bigger than ours. We've managed to somehow navigate that by listening to our community, taking the advice of people like EBRD, IFC, and the other international organizations in Bosnia and getting that right. In terms of our sustainability journey, really what we're saying is that pre-2022, we were getting everything in place. This year is a year about actually starting to enact these things. We're finishing our community development plan. We're working with microfinance organizations. We're setting up, helping entrepreneurs set up to take advantage of the economic uplift that we're already seeing in the town. We're seeing shops, bars, restaurant services opening up. And then really as we move into post-22, actually, that's our long-term value creation from our sustainability plan. We will publish a standalone sustainability report at the end of this year. That is not normal for a developer. We're not the only one, but few developers do that. We're going to try and be ahead of the game. We will shortly set out our five-year net zero plan. We will set out our other targets within that and then record ourselves against that on our sustainability report each year. I've got to hurry up a bit, I talked briefly about the Adriatic Foundation, but again, fundamentally, this was set up to bridge that gap, that expectation gap between the concession fee and the royalty. We increased the concession fee a little, but there is still a gap. And we will put, not only it's been seeded by us, but our financiers, in fact, someone in the room, I think, has helped seed this as well. Thank you, Richard. And we will put a proportion of our profits in to bridge that expectation gap, to make sure that in the future the community gets what it needs, and also to make sure that these are long-term sustainable capital investments in that community. I talked about the financing. I think the details there are available for you if you want to dig in, but broadly again, Orion Resource Partners, our financing was a mixture of debt, equity raised just before it, and a very small copper stream. I think the point I want to make here is that we have such a low capex, which you saw at the start. We went into this with an available contingency of 46 million. We are still forecasting that we are on budget and on time, or a relatively small budget, but certainly within our, what we've got within our contingency. We've got up to a 30% cost inflation. We were able to actually to change some of our engineering as the world started to collapse in January, so we've managed to engineer out some of the steel, and replace it with concrete. Main one is diesel. We're managing this, but diesel has gone up hugely. Clearly coming to the end, I think I'm all right. Yeah. In terms of corporate structure, are there anything I want to point out? Our shares have taken a bit of hammering over the last couple of weeks. Everyone's has. Yeah, so we sit here with government bonds and equities falling at the same time, and no one really able to explain to me what the heck that means. But I think in many ways, of course, that further presents the opportunity, I'd like to think, with us. We're trading at just under 0.4 NAV. So we're trading currently at a market capitalization UK of about 300 million sterling. So there's a lot of room for appreciation as we advance and achieve our construction targets, as we achieve our milestones, as we report back to you guys that we're actually doing this properly and we're getting there. There's a lot of growth coming forward in that. Corporate strategy, I've pretty much covered that. Generate near-term cash flow, get this mine up and running. This is a mine, we build this mine, we're going to build a company. We need to extend the mine life. I've talked through that and we'll do that. But we are also ambitious. We are going to be a multi-asset, mid-cap, mid-tier European producer, because going back to my point at the start, Europe is where we need to be. Europe needs access to raw materials. Europe needs to underpin its manufacturing base. Europe needs to do something about supply chain chaos, resource scarcity, resource fragility, which is only forecast to get considerably worse. So we're in the right place. We're in Europe. Our concentrates are smelted in Europe. It's the right project. Our economics are captivating, they are solid, and we are delivering on that. And in terms of time, I don't think I can think of a better time to be delivering Europe's next new mine. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you.
Thank you. Okay, so for those of you who heard that presentation last night, is it even more compelling the second time that you're here?
Ask Mr. Geddes, please.
Bill, are you happy?
Yes, much clearer.
Do you know what? This is the first time I've heard him speak, and I've been doing this for 7 years, so he's happy. Very good. So just towards the end there, you'd anticipated a question, which is, are you still on budget and on course for development in spite of inflation of some of the bits and pieces that you need to get this going?
Yeah, I think critically here, we've locked in the long lead time items. We've locked them in with sufficient time in there to mitigate what is still happening in the shipping world. It's not quite the answer you looked for. In terms of cross-price inflation, of course, diesel, electricity, steel, we're seeing that. But Bosnia doesn't have a large import-export trade balance gap. It's not quite as exposed. Energy prices, the country's fixed energy prices for the rest of this year. The principal one has been diesel. I think it's 72% uplift in diesel. We re-rated the other day. We re-budgeted internally in the company. We are still well within the contingency that we took into the start of this project on the budget side, and we are on time as well to deliver first pour of concentrates in June next year.
So when you took on this project in 2017, were you aware that you had such a delicious smorgasbord?
No. No. This was a proper punt. Paul Crane and our CEO basically put everything into this. We hit that discovery hole. It was stellar. We then stepped out, moved the drill out. I can't remember if it was 50 or 100 metres. Again, with very little money left, we missed everything. The geologist then said to the CEO, could we actually place the next drill hole rather than you? And they brought it back into the ore body. And then really from that ASX listing, from the funding we got on that, and the support we've actually had from our retail investors and still do now, we've taken it to this. And it really is, one of the highest grade polymetallics being brought to bear anywhere. And one thing I didn't mention earlier, of course, the thing with the polymetallic is 50% of our revenue is base metals. And 50% is precious metals. So you're actually internally hedged here against quite a few different market scenarios. Although we could argue later whether silver is precious or industrial. I don't mind which. But increasingly, actually, in the green revolution, silver is playing its part in the photovoltaic panels and electric car charging. Not the cars, but the fast charging network needs a lot of silver. So silver is shifting on the dial on precious to industrial.
I was just a little bit concerned there. Is the boss, Mr. Crane, is he a micromanager or is he an amateur geologist?
He's a visionary. A visionary, a driven visionary. Yes, exactly. No, he's a financier.
Very good, I understand. Just don't let him anywhere near that rig. Yes, that's a question from the back there.
Yeah. I think you mentioned at the start that there was four metals you were going to extract through the smelting process. Yet you mentioned that there are many more metals there and there are all these other deposits round. As you go forward, is it likely that you might increase the range of metals you smelt? I'm not up to speed with this myself, but obviously one of the issues with rare metals is that the West doesn't produce enough of these.
No, indeed. Let's just be clear. So our deposit contains economically viable lead, zinc, silver, gold, copper, and antimony. Some of the smelters will pay for antimony, some of them won't, but it's very, very marginal on that. This is a classic sort of polymetallic. Within our exploration area, it is unlikely that we would find any other metals than that. In terms of what we produce a bulk lead-silver concentrate, where the lead and the silver report, and then we produce a zinc concentrate, and these other metals, the copper and the gold, mostly go into that zinc concentrate. And then it's over to the smelters to recover those metals. And each one of them, whether it be our contracts are with Nystar up in Belgium and with Boliden up in Scandinavia, and the contracts are a little bit different for each of them in terms of how they pay for those different metals. In terms of Bosnia and the Rupitsa and the Vares project, we will continue to find polymetallic lead zinc hosted deposits. Elsewhere, we look at, looking at a range of other metals, sat there within really what we call the transition metals, so those important base metals that will help fuel net zero, and still looking at some precious. But we are not looking at any of the sort of rare earths or anything like that. Yes, there's work in Scandinavia, but that's not where we're focused at the moment.
Dominic, that's it. Thank you very, very much indeed. Dominic Roberts, Head of Corporate Affairs, Adriatic Metals, which is run by a visionary.
It is indeed.